Hello and welcome back. Welcome to our first panel of the day. We're going to talk about digitization of grid infrastructure, and we're going to ask how we're going to go from chatbots to digital grid control, whatever that means. I'm going to briefly introduce the panel, and they're all experts on grid infrastructure and grid technologies and what's coming next. First, there is Dr. Tao. He is the Vice President, Business Innovation and Digital at Energy Networks E.ON. And he is someone who's very passionate and really driving the digital tools in this organization and beyond. He's going to talk a little bit about the strategy behind all this. Yeah, welcome to the stage.
Thank you
for being here. Next in line, we have Susanne Fabri. Susanne Fabri is head of steering energy networks at E.ON in Germany. She is a lawyer by training, so we got that perspective today. And I know she's pretty passionate also about sustainability issues and municipalities and the whole politics around energy in this world. Thanks for being here. And then last but not least, we have Dr. Stefan Küppers. He's the managing director at Vestnetz. And now he is someone who knows the German net, the German grid, better than probably most of us. And I'm very excited to hear what's happening in terms of innovation in the German grid. Now, to start off, I want to hand over to Dr. Tao to give us a few impressions and maybe a vision for what could happen next.
Thank you very much, Christoph. Just now, we have guests before in the keynotes from Thomas. There could be lots of interesting there. I'm a little surprised how many interesting there. We are talking about digitalization. We are talking about scale. We are talking about rollout. So that's we took 20 minutes to share with you how we are running within E.ON regarding digitalization. We are a huge company. I come to the next chart. It's very well known. It's a huge company from two big companies to one. We are very proud to connect people and supply reliable power supply and renewable. Yeah? Thomas mentioned before, roughly 1 million renewables connect to our grid. And we have more than 40 million customers. If you, again, we're talking about size. We're talking about how can we speed up for the scale up. You can imagine that we are in more than 10 countries. We speak different languages. Imagine it. So it's very interesting. So we have huge difference in language, maybe in thinking. But for me personally, exactly why the benefits for innovation and digitalization. Without difference, we can never make any digital innovation. And that's exactly why we have friends in each country. We understand the needs from the people, from the customers, and we'll try to use our best of experience to leverage in Europe. So for me personally, innovation comes from decentralized people. For our colleges, more than 8,000 people in the field, and they have close connection to customers and connection to our employees and partners. They know exactly the pain points and needs of customers. That's our strength for scale besides size. But you could ask, how can we manage a huge company? Actually, it's quite important to drive a radical innovation digitalization, not just incremental improvement. Imagine that we have huge challenge before us, complexity, and new requirements for customers. We are still in the beginning of energy transition in some countries. We are still far before us. So our way of E.ON, we are not centralized to drive digitalization or innovation. Our version is to put each part of strengths from local, decentralized innovation to so-called big picture. That's our one E.ON big picture. We form chatbot, customer interaction, and digital supplies, sensors. Later, Stefan mentioned much more to put it together to make synergies between us and to accelerate the speed. That's exactly the way we are running. We apply a so-called state of art and art of possibility. Just now you asked quite a lot of questions to Thomas. Just believe me, if you imagine we apply every kind of new technologies within E.ON in our energy networks. But of course, we're at different stage of rollout. If it works very well, we make roll out. But it takes time. But we are very excited to do this. And it's, that's a way, I would say, very unique way we Aon drive our digitalization in our own way compared to our friends, maybe in Europe, worldwide. But digitalization is not only regarding technology. We are still thinking about people. We will never get enough people in the future to do the same job. We have more jobs in the future. So we need a young generation with digital skills. But at the same time, we need to upskill our employees with lots of experience. We have to copy their experience, their brain, in a more digital way to enable our future. That's my exactly two or three statements to how we are driving there. I will go further, hands over to Stefan to go more detail what we are driving.
Thank you so much, Stefan. Stage is yours, please.
Continue, and I was not sure whether Tao would mention the big picture digital. He mentioned, at the end of the day, we will try to take all the people with us talking about and implementing this big picture. But to be more concrete, what do we think about smartification of our energy networks? What are the examples that we are talking about? And I took two with me to speak about. And as I heard in the section before, the interview and the questions to Thomas, there was one question around the substation. And here is an example how we think about real concrete automation of our substations. Why is it so important? Because actually, in the medium and low voltage grid in Germany, we have no automation. They are purely disautomated, as we can speak about this like this. And we need more information. We need a remote control section. We need communication to be really able to see the situation, the data coming from that substation. And for example, to have real-time data to really balance the generation and the consumption of our consumers, or to be able to have a real intelligent outage management, because actually people are calling, phoning, if there is no electricity, and this is not the state of the art yet, if we really talk about digitalization. So we try not only to use them for the information, but for example, to do a very intelligent outage management. And a second example, which is quite important and shows how automation and digitalization should go on, is using drones. In the speech of Thomas, he showed the short film and the example of the drones, so putting some equipment to the lines. And what our idea is, and the first things are just started, taking all the experts of the different companies with us, is that we implement drones for taking pictures of our overhead lines and the poles and the pylons to detect faults. And detection of faults is speeched out very easy, but to have the intelligence to really detect what the fault is, this takes some time. This is the example we are just working on. And not only to detect the fault itself, but as a preparation for the repair that is needed then. And in the second step, once being able to take the pictures, we intend to do a repair by the drones very automatically too. Then we saw it before in our short film. And it's a big, big task that will last for a few years because you need a very large number of pictures first, being able to detect the faults, having patterns that you can see, then doing the automation. First, the people will be will be included in the process. Later on, it should run very automatically. And then in the second step, as I told, then we try to evaluate the pictures, to detect the patterns, and then to do the second step to the automatic repair process. And another problem that we have yet is that the batteries of the drones are quite small. They last only for a few minutes of flying time. And to be able to work with our big and large grid, it needs another, let's say, another category of drones, other battery packs, and the equipment to carry, repairing equipments, and so on. But we are on the track. We just started, and it's the second example that I wanted to show.
Thank you so much, Stefan. Sabine, you're going to show us something too, right? what are you going to show us, and what's your input? What's your thought on this?
Yes, thank you very much. I want to put the light on one of our special customer groups and show you in Germany we have a special system. It's that the municipalities, they are a sort of our customers because they give us the license to have our grid in their ground. And this is something which can be changed by the municipality every 20 years, some of them every 10 years. And so we are always in a high competition among the different grid companies to be able to have the grid in the, or to work on the grid in the municipality. And so we thought about what can we do also for our customer municipalities to lift them up to the next level of digitalization. We are doing so much in the grid and also in the internal processes, what can we do for the externals? And this is what I want to show you a little bit about. We have, you can see here, we are now in the German grid. You can imagine I'm from the German grid. We have a lot of communities that are connected to our grids. We have a lot of people there which are connected. We have about 9,000 communities which are our partners in the grid areas, some smaller ones, some larger ones. For example, the city of Essen is also, you can see here in the background, city of Essen is one of our partners, but we have also very lot of small partners where we can, let's say, assist them, or we have to listen to them, what are their topics, what do they want, what is their need to be better and to have their targets reached. What are targets of a municipality? They want, and this is a very common topic at the moment, we need to reduce CO2. So the climate is a very big topic when we talk with the municipalities, and so we thought, what can we do with that? We have about 800,000 infeeders of renewable energy connected to our grids. What can we do with that? What can give us there a possibility also to bring it together with the municipalities? This is something we think about, and we try to find good solutions for the future, and two of them I want to show here. We have now a lot of numbers. I talked about them. Maybe something. We have about 80% green electricity in our grid. And this is also something that we can use also for the municipalities. I think this is also a very important topic. So I will show you two solutions. One of them is the Klimanavi. We have introduced together with some colleagues in the Hansewerk. They had the idea for their municipalities to give a Klimanavi. So you can, at the push of a button, see how is the CO2 balance in your grid area, in your municipal grid area. And you can also see where and how can you improve that within the next year. So we can make you really lines to show. You can, for example, exchange your public lighting, or you can exchange the heating in the school or something like that. And then you can see how CO2 is decreasing. And you can, on a push of a button, you can really see it. And you see here on the picture that there are better municipalities and also not the good municipalities. And also they have a little bit then to compete with each other, who can be the better in the CO2 reduction. And another example, which is also very interesting, we try to make a platform that you can buy CO2 free energy from your neighbors. We have a lot of obstacles in the German legislation against this, But this is really a try to show you where are CO2-free infeeders of renewable energy, bring them together with the people who need energy, and then we can make a platform where you can buy and sell your renewable energy. And this is something that also for communities is very interesting, because their people in their regions, they have really the possibility to buy regional electricity. And this is also one of my favorite topics, to see that really people like it to be on these platforms.
Thank you so much, Susanna. This is super interesting. A few things I'm hearing. there seems to be a trend in all of what you're looking at, not only to look at the bigger cities, but to going in all areas and say communities of energy could be anywhere. What's your take on that, Tao?
For me, if you look at me, I come from Asia, yeah? So a huge difference if I travel last year from my hometown from Shanghai to Germany. It's not really a city here. It's lots of small towns, but I like it. I lived 20 years here. I studied here. That's what I want to emphasize, this difference for me personally. In Europe, especially in Germany, we have small towns. That's our focus. Mm-hmm. Do not think about how can you make smart cities or anything there for huge mega cities. We do not really have to do huge mega cities. It's Berlin, 3 million people. That's it. And Susanna, much better, listen to the voice of small municipalities. Listen to the people, what they need. For me, personally, where from thinking and from culture here, I really like German culture and European culture. It's something different. It's not big, much bigger size, but you do very, very good way. Susanna mentioned just now the CO2 transparency. You have to make transparent to let everybody know what happened. From my person, I learned as children, child, yeah, you get the information, do it. Maybe, Susanna, what's about your view?
So the visibility is something you're after.
It's really, I think this is really important. And as Tao already mentioned, we have a look at the smaller municipalities. We have in what I showed in the north of Germany, in Hansewerk, we have municipalities that have only 150 or 160 inhabitants. Mm-hmm. Or some of them, we have a lot of municipalities between 1,000 and 2,000 inhabitants, or between 2,000 and 5,000 inhabitants. And those ones, they also want to be a part of this climate action. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's not so easy for them to work on that. And you have communities, you can have communities also in these rural areas where you have the smaller villages, and it's for them also very important to be a part of it. And digitalization gives us the possibility to give them the chance to be a part of it. And this is for me very important. And also to see that there can then be a competition. And it's interesting for people or for municipalities when they are in competition, then they have the good ideas in order to reduce CO2. And I think this climate change is going to be to work much better when people really are keen to do it and to work on it.
Mm-hmm. Stefan, how do you see this? The Green Deal, and this push for renewables or better energy system, this is something that apparently the users are really after. The consumer is driven by that, and that brings them to adopt new innovation. Is that something you're seeing too?
Absolutely, and it's not only the influence on the concession givers, the municipalities, but the customer itself. We all are customers by ourselves, and I just implemented at my home in January, not only the generation with PV, but a first storage in my cellar. And now I see what is possible actually now, having the technology of today. But if we drive it forward and think about it, what's possible in 10 years, in 20 years, I think it will be a radical change. The customers, not only the municipality, but the customers themselves are the drivers. In together with the technical innovation, the digitalization that we are talking about, and the game will change. The game will change. There will be more decentral generation, especially in rural areas, where wind farms and PV will be implemented. But in cities, in very dense populated areas, I think PV will be increasing part two. Mm-hmm. And for that reason, we have to take the customers, the development with us, but not to be behind the development, but to get in front of it, to be a front runner by ourselves. We have the size, we have the power, we have the knowledge, yeah. And we should be on the part of that development.
And for me personally, energy transition and sustainable everything in focus our people, our customers. Well, we really like our job because we operate grids, and today everyone's connected to grids. It's fantastic. If you look worldwide, lots of people do not have internet, but less people have power, but almost everybody power supply. So we require internet energy in the future. Mm. So we think we can make much more. We connect people. And so digitalization helps us quite a lot to make things happen. As Stefan said, much quicker and faster. And so Susanna said to reach everyone, mm-hmm. not only focus some people. Mm. Digitalization, energy transition is not selected people. It's for all of us. Mm. Even in this way working and also within us, I just mentioned before how we drive digitalization and innovation within our company, even we are a decentralized organization, but we have all common one picture. Stefan, you will agree, I hope.
Yes, so, of course.
So that's the one vision, drive it together and what makes things happen. Like Thomas said, we are always in focus in this way.
Susanna mentioned the competition that sometimes shows up when people see and measure their own success versus the success of others. So that seems something that drives municipalities to compete in a friendly way and for a greater good. Now, you mentioned before, Tao, that decentral organizations, are they better equipped maybe to deal with the areas outside the bigger cities because they have more access to the customer needs and they understand better what's going on? Or what's the reason decentralized organization is a good way to deal with this?
Look, just think about the energy system. And we have in Europe, especially, a mega trend, it's decentralization. Mm-hmm. And the Corona put more regionalization. Mm-hmm. So Susanna mentioned before, to enable customers to buy things from your neighbor, it's really a trend. So just follow trends, listen what the people need. Mm-hmm. That's a way we organize our Aeon in different decentralized organizations. I really like the way, because you have directly touch point to people. Mm-hmm. You know immediately what they need. But on the other side, of course, it's complicated to organize everything. So we need leadership. So we need a very strong leadership and very strong culture. We have to learn to sharing, right, to work together. I think we are quite on a good way. And if I imagine what happened in 10 years, we'll be a huge company with lots of knowledge and innovation and digitalization, but drive always in one direction with lots of parsers from individual employees and companies. Mm-hmm. That's my personal version and view.
Yeah, maybe also we focus at the moment very on Germany. We have also in other countries very large grids, electricity grids, gas grids, and also communities. For example, in Sweden, we have also very lot of solutions, a lot of grid. And I, for myself, worked for 5 years in Czech Republic. Mm-hmm. It's also, we have a big electricity and gas grid over there. And it's really the interesting thing. And I think this is something that is very Aeon special, that we have decentralized developments that we are able to put over to others, to learn from each other and to be also there in a little bit of competition, really keen to use other solutions. We just put it with a lot of colleagues, not only from Germany, but also from other countries. And also these examples that I had for Germany, I think they are also very interesting for Sweden. The people work there also. We are also in exchange with colleagues over there in order to find the best thing. And as Tao said, to listen to people, what is there on, to really get a feeling what the people out there, what they like, what they need from us. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just to add what both of them said, and Susanne, I think people more and more want to take over responsibility. Our customers want to get more responsibility, for example, for implementing technologies to get their energy in, by CO2 free or less CO2 to regarding energies. And what is possible is that we think from our customer needs, that we take into account what, for example, the European Green Deal is, and then try to get solutions. Mm. And not only for the electricity grid, but for the whole energy demands that the people have. Mm. To think about in a new energy system where it's not possible to combine the generation with the needs of the customers. It's not possible without digitalization. It's not possible without coupling of the energy sectors, electricity, gas, which could be in the future, hydrogen, then the heating and the cooling, which is necessary for our customers, to take all this into account. And the basic technology to combine it is digitalization and automation.
Yeah.
Thank you. There's a question about decentralized energy seems like a lucrative idea. Now, is there a conflict of making this decentralized, and if it's customer driven and they bring down their consumption, is this a conflict with your profit goals in any way? Or do you see this as a push?
I think we have two objectives. Our company, of course, we have profit as targets, but at the same time, we take our social responsibility. We, three of us emphasize always listen to customer. So the decentralized system, it's really left, especially in Germany, it drives in. Stefan mentioned before, Thomas showed before, they have PV, solar, they have storage, they have everything. So why should we against them? Just work with customer hand in hand. Mm. It's the future. I do not think there is a huge conflict there. Mm-hmm. The culture and the art of work is how can we capture and leverage our knowledge with a new opportunity to make new business. Without innovation, we will die, a lesson learned, so we follow it.
Right, okay. So you don't see that conflict, and that's interesting and great to see. So if you look at the next 10 years, this is my final question to all of you. Could you give me very briefly, What's your vision? What would you like to see in 10 years? Where are we? Going from where you are now, whoever wants to start.
Yeah, I try to start take some questions into account.
Yes.
The system that we are driving in and operating in 10 years, and I think we will in 10 years be the operator of this energy system, has to be secure. This is a question that every time appears. I'm responsible for the security of our SCADA systems. Absolutely. And they will be secure. We will do as much as we can to operate secure systems. And there will be less centrally feeded by bigger energy power plants, but we will have big power plants in 10 years. For that reason, I think there will be more decentral renewable energy. There will be much more interest of our customers. They will generate themselves. They will store themselves. They will be a partner. But the system will be in between compared to today.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Susanne. I see us in a big transition also within 10 years, as also Stefan said. My dream is that we use much more of the energy that is there. So this is also something we can really improve. We have at the moment discussions with data centers. They have a big output of energy and nobody uses it. Mm-hmm. And also some, let's say, in the industry, we see big customers that can use a lot of their energy which is going out instead to use it for own purposes or to sell it. I think we will come to much more fluid systems, and this will also reduce, let's say, the big things, and we'll go to a smaller but also really steered system.
Thank you.
For me, actually, I have lots of vision, but 10 years is not quite a lot. By 10 years, lots of things happen. Imagine iPhone, like here, Thomas said before. It's many things will happen. What do we have to do, in my vision, to collect lots of data and build up our capability? In the end, knowledge wins. in the end, listen to customers, work with customers. My version have every customer say, great, you Aon. Thank you for your help. What I learned, I was operating in North Germany. If I met a majors, people, everyone said, thank you very much. Due to a customer outage time, you are there, not someone else. That's our advantage. That's my version. Customer capability.
Perfect. Thank you so much for these clear statements at the end. Thanks to the panel, Tao, Susanne, and Stefan. Thanks for being here, taking the time. We're at the end of this session, and we'll be back at 12:45 after a 15-minute break. See you then.